She was one of those pretty and charming girls, born into a family of artisans. She had no marriage portion or expectations, no means of getting known, understood, loved, and wedded by a man of wealth and distinction. And she let herself be married off to a little clerk in the Ministry of Education. She suffered from the poorness of her house, from its mean walls, worn chairs, and ugly curtains. She imagined silent antechambers, heavy with oriental tapestries, lit by torches and lofty bronze sockets, with two tall footmen in knee breeches, sleeping in large armchairs, overcome by the heavy warmth of the stove. She imagined vast saloons hung with antique silks, exquisite pieces of furniture supporting priceless ornaments, and small, charming perfumed rooms created just for little parties of intimate friends, men who were famous and sought after, whose homage roused every other woman's envious longings.
Ah, Scotchfroth, what could be better?
But she imagined delicate meals, gleaming silverware. She imagined delicate food served in marvelous dishes, murmured gallantries, listened to with an inscrutable smile, as one trifled with the rosy flesh of trout or wings of asparagus chicken.
I have something for you.
The Minister of Education and Madame Raponneau request the pleasure of the company of Monsieur and Madame Loisel at the Ministry on the evening of Monday, January the 18th. What am I supposed to do with this?
Oh, darling, I thought you'd be pleased. You never go out, and there'll be big people there. Everyone wants one.
What am I supposed to wear to such an affair?
Well, the dress that you wear at the theater, it looks very nice to me. What's the matter with you?
Well, maybe you should give it to someone that's wife could go that would look better than I shall.
Look here, Mattel, what could be the cost of a suitable dress that you wear on more than one occasion?
Well, I expect around 400 francs.
This was exactly the amount he had been saving for a gun, intending to get a little shooting next summer on the plain of Nanterre with some friends who went lark shooting there on Sundays.
Well, I'll give you 400 francs if you have to buy something really nice with it.
The day of the party drew near, and Madame Loisel seemed sad, uneasy, and
in fact, we were for 3 days there.
I'm miserable. I have no jewels, and I will look like no one. I would rather not go.
But wear flowers are good this time of year.
No, that's humiliating. I'll look poor and amongst a bunch of rich women.
How stupid. Go see Madame Forrester.
The next day, she went to see her friend and told her her trouble.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good.
Come over here.
Choose, my dear.
Haven't you anything else?
Yes. Choose for yourself. I'm not sure what you would like best.
This one, just this one, please.
Yes, of course.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
She was the prettiest woman present, elegant, graceful, smiling, and quite above herself with happiness. All the men stared at her, inquired her name, and asked to be introduced to her. All the undersecretaries of the state were eager to waltz with her. The minister noticed her. She danced madly, ecstatically, drunk with pleasure, with no thought for anything in the triumph of her beauty, and the pride of her success, in a cloud of happiness made up of this universal homage and admiration, of the desires she had aroused, of the completeness of a victory so dear to her feminine heart.
Doing it, wait, I want to
go. I just want to go home.
Me too. They must be having a good time, unlike us.
Yep.
Thank you.
on the ball?
I did. I touched it.
Well, if it fell on the street, you wouldn't heard it fall.
Well, did you get the number of the cab?
No, I didn't notice it. Did you?
No.
Well, I'll go look over where we walked for a bit.
Okay. Husband returned about 7, but had found nothing. He went to the police station. The newspapers to offer a reward to the cab companies everywhere that a ray of hope impelled him.
You have to write to your friend and we'll see you about getting the damage.
Found a necklace similar to the one that they had lost, except it was 36,000 francs, money which they did not have. He went door to door looking for loans for money to pay off the necklace. Finally, after many loans, they were able to pay off the necklace.
Here you go. Well, you could have brought it back sooner. I might have needed it.
Sorry.
Madame Michelle came to know the ghastly life of abject poverty. This fearful debt must be paid off. She would pay it. The servant was dismissed. She came to know the heavy work of the house, the hateful duties of the kitchen. She washed the plates, wearing out her pink nails, and the coarse pottery in the bottoms of pans. She washed the dirty linen, the shirts, and the dishcloths, and hung them out to dry on a string. Every morning, she took the dustpan down into the street and carried out the water, stopping on each landing to get her breath. And, clad like a poor woman, she went to the fruiterer, to the grocer, to the butcher, a basket on her arm, haggling, insulted, fighting for every wretched halfpenny of her money.
Madame Loiselle looked old now. She had become like all the other strong, hard, coarse women of poor household. Her hair was badly done, her skirts were rear, her hands were red.
One Sunday, as she had gone for a walk along the Champs-Élysées to freshen herself up after the labors of the week, she caught sight suddenly of a woman who was taking a child out for a walk. It was Madame Forestier, still young, still beautiful, still attractive.
Morning, Jean. I'm sorry, you must have made a mistake.
No, it's me, Madame Loiselle.
Oh, well, you have changed.
Yes, I've had some hard times, and all on your account.
My account? What do you mean?
You remember that necklace that I borrowed from you at the ministry back when?
Yes, well?
Well, I had lost it, and I rebought you a new one.
What do you mean? You bought me a diamond necklace to replace that?
Yes, I saved up for 10 years.
Mine was just a fake. Mine was only worth 500 francs.